Hey guys, this is George, and today I'm going to read a Tigerdirect catalog from 1998. Today is March 2017, which makes this catalog 19 years old. So I'm sure the technology has changed a lot in things that we remember from 19 years ago, but I think this should be a very fun episode of to see what's changed in 20 years in computers. So let's see what we got here. This is the cover, and this is from 1998, tigerdirect.com, and end of the year event. And look, we have Windows 95, we have Windows 98, and Windows NT. Wow. So no XP, no nothing else. It was 95, 98, and NT, and prior to that, we had Windows 3.1 and Windows for workgroups. And on the title here, on the title page, we have memory sale, 16 megabytes right here, 16 megabytes for $41, 32 megabytes for $80, and zip drives. You guys remember zip drives? It hold a measly 256 megabytes, and that was your storage. That was storage a little bit beyond your floppy and between the CD-ROM, which hold 650 megabytes. This one hold 250. And the originals only hold about 100. But that was your storage right there. We got monitors. Check this monitor out. The Sylvania 19-inch CRT monitor for $460. Here's a 17-inch monitor. Now, these are CRTs. These are not flat screens or LEDs, LCD. It's none of those. It's actually all tube. So we got a 14-inch, 15-inch. Let's see what we got. What else we got in here? We're going to skip some of the things, like these robotic systems, which I think only lasted a couple of years, and then they disappeared. But here's a whole system ready to run IBM Citrix base processor for $800, and this is running a Celeron. Wow, Celeron. That was prior to the Pentium. They actually had Celeron and Pentium machines. Let's see, let's get to the good stuff. Let's see what we got here. Check out this PC here for $629. 300 megahertz. These are cheaper than your Intel machines or CPUs, with 64 megabytes of memory, and the hard drive space is 4.3 gigabytes. Look at that. Just amazing. Only a 4K video memory. Very nice. Oh, look at that. It's faster than a Pentium 2, and that is the AMD 3D with 3D now, and that's the machine you got. How much is this machine? Does it say? Actually, you build your system here. You have three systems. Let me see if I can pull this up a little bit so you can see the bottom. 300 megahertz, 639, and the fastest one in here is a 350 megahertz K6 for almost $1,000. Let me bring this back to normal. So more machines. And now we get to the ultimate machine, the Pentium 2, 450 megahertz. Yes, 450 megahertz. And the Pentium 2 did come in these slot one cartridges. So it wasn't the CPU wasn't on the physical motherboard like we plug it in now. It was a card that actually sat inside right here where I'm indicating, and that's what their CPU would go. Networking stations. Here's a server series for $2,100. Some Aptivas, some Compaqs. These are all in the 300 and 400 megahertz range. And you had a choice, like I said, AMD, you had Intel. Here's AMD. These are memory chips. Look at these memory chips here. Four megabytes. And I believe this is a single chip. Excuse me. 4 megabytes, $19, and 64 megabyte memory chips worth $114. Here's the card again that I was telling you, the Pentium on a card, slot one. Break the speed limit, really, at 180 to 240. And these are AMDs, if I'm correct. No, these are Pentiums with MMX. MMX was like a graphical, if I'm correct, it's like a graphical thing. It speeds up the process. Solis, these are Tiger Solis laptops. This is probably a laptop made just for them, for these people. And the top of the line system here is a Pentium MMX or a Pentium 2 with 64 megabytes of memory. And let's see what the hard drive is. The hard drive, where are you? Hard drive is either 2, 4, or 6.4 gigabytes. Okay, so 6.4 gigabytes for $2,300. The runtime on this is 3 hours according to that, but trust me, it's not going to last 3 hours. Here's a PC, IBM. There's some Presarios. They also had those too. Toshiba. These were little personal organizers and notebooks. This is before, I guess, the PDA. Here's the PDA. We'll get to that in a minute. But these were cheaper alternatives, and you can access your email and all that good stuff through a phone. It actually acted like a modem, and you can dial into your AOL or your POP server. And this probably had a very, very slow modem, but these were personal organizers. So, and then this is the PDA. This is basically your old iPad. This is what they look like before there was an iPad. And the Palm Pilot all the way over here in the corner. Here's the zip drives that I was telling you about. The 100 for $99 is 100 megabytes that you can store. They had the 200, which is probably around here somewhere. And then look at this one. This is 2 gigabyte storage for $339. Hard drive sales, 10 gigabyte for $249. I remember buying how much was that? It was a 27 or a 30 gigabyte hard drive, and I paid $249 a couple of years later, about maybe 3 years later. It was the same price, so back then you could only get that. So hard drive speeds here, the fastest drive here is a SCSI drive, which is 18 gigabyte hard drive is the biggest drive you can find. That's a SCSI 3 drive, and that was $1,100. That's a server or graphic intense hard drive. But you had the small ones here, a 4.3 IDE all the way to 10 gigabyte, and here is a 16 gigabyte, and that one's $499. So you have IDE and SCSI. SuperDisk. SuperDisk was one of these nice creation, which was it looked almost like a regular floppy disk. It's almost the same size. It was made by Innovation, and it was 120 megabytes, and the cost of that was $149, and a pack of three CDs or a pack of three discs was $39 a piece. For three of them. So that was kind of cool. And that's a floppy drive here. And I might be wrong, but I believe you can actually use a regular floppy here too. So it'll read a regular floppy, 3.5, and this type of floppy in the same drive. UPSs, battery backup systems. This was one of those things where the ISOTEL or ISO bar, as we used to call them, which were power protection, all the offices had this because it was a big thing of computer, you know, power surge and brownouts and all that good stuff. So in a lot of desks, you would see one of these ISO bars, as I call them, or ISOTEL, which is, I guess, the brand for this. Triplight makes them surge protectors, but there is no battery in here. Here's a big, big 500 kV or VA, sorry, $99 battery backup. I think they were kind of cool because they would stand up like that. It'll look like your PC, but much smaller, obviously. And the plugs in the back. And of course, if you had one of those wall warts, forget about it. You're going to have to plug it in up here because, you know, there's no room in the back, but they were cool. I do remember that brand. APC has been around for a long, long time, and I think it's one of the better units out there. $50 rebate, season greetings from HP. I get $50 if I buy any PC and whatever garbage. I'm not doing that. When does this expire? 1999. This one is expire 1999. Printers. Inkjet printers. Here's the laser jet printers. Laser jet printers were still pretty expensive. Pretty expensive. Here's a standard HP laser jet printer for $1,500. And you had a little personal one for $400, which was not a good printer. People were still using inkjet. Inkjet were the printers, and the most expensive inkjet, according to this page, 10 page per minute in black and white, $800. And the cheapest one is 5 page per minute at $179. Epson printers. Canon printers. Oki Data. Oh my god, these are dot matrix printer. You guys know what dot matrix printers are? Well, they were definitely on their way out already. I mean, they were just barely in existence. In 1998, but some companies still needed them, so they sold, I guess, only one. That is that's probably a 9-pin. I was gonna say 7-pin, but 7-pin was closer to the 80s, and then after the 90s, they brought it up to 9-pin. Monitors, 17-inch monitor right here, and look at the resolution here. Top of the line resolution, okay, on a, let's see, let's pick this one here, the Avitron 15-inch, 1024 by 768 for $239, and then you have a whopping 21-inch monitor, 1600 by 1200 resolution for $739. I believe these are Korean monitors. This is who knows what, Daytek. Sony Trinitrons were very, very expensive. A 21-inch Sony Trinitron, which is 1600 by 1200, was $1,300. So if you wanted a 21-inch monitor back then, that's how much you're going to pay. And again, these are CRTs. This is an actual tube, so it's not a flat monitor. It's not a flat screen. Now, here's the funny one. Next generation in displays, Spectre. And here you go. Now we finally found an LCD screen. And this is a small 12-inch 800 by 600 resolution for $800. And they were huge. They were bulky. And they were very fat, 2.5 inches thick in the back. So a 14-inch would cost you $1,000, and a 12-inch would cost you $800. And the resolution's only 800 by 600 on the 20 on the 12, and 1200 by 768 on the 14-inch. Video cards. Okay, this is where we laugh again, because the video cards start at $70 and they go all the way. There's probably more expensive ones in here, but on these here, they're Diamond, Stealth, and Viper series. I believe the Viper were the better one, which is going by the price. The V550 is $180, And that one, the specs of that is, let's see where we have here. The 550 is a 16 megabyte SD RAM PCI slot, a total refresh rate of 125 megahertz, 1820 by 1200, 16 million colors, and it's $200, basically $180. CD writers. By the way, there was no DVD writer, so you're not going to see DVD or Blu-ray writers at this time. Memorex CD-ROM writer. Look at this, 2X Write for $249. The media, a 10-pack, was $15. Here's a Yamaha. Well, one of the things that was in is the RW, which is pretty cool because you can rewrite on the same disc. So you can actually erase it and rewrite it. So the CD-RW is kind of cool. I'm kind of choking here, but and I didn't bring water. Here's some media. A 50-pack would cost $74. 100-pack, $39. Oh, no, those are floppies. Those are floppies. So this is all the little media that they had. And this was pretty cool. This company, Nido, was the first company that actually patented and created a way for you to put a paper label on a CD. So this was pretty cool. They came with the software. That was $49. Here's some more CDRs. Look at this. Duplicate your CD-ROM. Basically put the CD in here and duplicate it over here. Only a measly $1,800. That's crazy. Standalone CD duplicator, $1,600, man. Wow. Some of the programs that for music production that was in was the Acid Sound Forge. This was for music editing, and then this one was for creating tracks and stuff like that. It was really cool. Speakers, look at this, little speakers you can put on your Kinko, which is, this is the cheapest shit of shit right here. Kingyo, amplified speakers from $24 to $80. Scanners was a big thing because cameras were around, but scanners was the thing you would, you know, scan a magazine. So if you had a magazine you wanted to scan or photos, you would basically grab, you know, put it on there and then hook it up and hit scan it, would scan it. So scanners was a very popular thing, and somebody scanned their keys there, as you can see. And you can see the prices on these $800, $900, $400, $200 for scanners. See, scanners was the big thing. There was scanners everywhere. Every office had a scanner. Here's more scanners. They also used it for faxing, too, because they can scan it from here and use a program, like a fax program that you can fax to your another office. So you can scan it here and hit fax, whatever. Hubs, big hubs. Tembase 110, no gigabyte here. These are 100 megabit. KVMs, these are a keyboard video and mouse. Basically, you connect four machines here, and then you connect a monitor, a mouse, and a keyboard, and you can connect four machines and switch between the four machines by pressing one of this button here. And it was really cool to use multiple machines. Ethernet wires, I'm gonna go through that. And modems, we're almost done here. These 56K, so I was wrong. 56K was the fastest modem. I said 96 earlier, but 96 was in the early 80s. So 56K modem, $49. That's fairly cheap already at that price. 3Com or US Robotics was one of the main companies that made modems, and they were usually a little bit more money. But the cheap ones work just fine. Here's US Robotics. ISDN, this is a nice little thing here. Let me talk a little bit about this. Before there was DSL, the fastest connection you can get was ISDN, which was basically almost like two modems, but they were running at 64 kbps, which was when everybody had a 9600 baud modem or 192 modem, somebody had a 64 megabits and you were the king. But you would have to pay a lot of money. This is actually cheap already because ISDN was on the way out. But ISDN cost a lot of money for the modem, and you had to pay a lot of money for the connection. But it was the only way for you to get 64 gigabytes, megabytes per second. And if you had a dual system, you can run up to 128, and that's what this is. A 128, which is double the 64 megabit. And you would have to dial in two, so you had two phone jacks to dial to your provider, and your provider had to give you two connections. So that was pretty cool. ISDN modems. And then after ISDN modems, obviously DSL is what came around. Or broadband. First it was broadband, then DSL. Broadband meaning through your cable subscriber. Fax modems. Delivers 2.4 gigahertz power. It's not power. Good Lord, that's just the megahertz that the communication is being transferred between the phone and the base. Standard, these are, by the way, I know I didn't say that, but these are your standard phones that you can use at an office or at home. And they used to, I believe they were at 48, when they first came out, they were at 48 kilo megahertz, and then they went up to 800 and 900 megahertz, which was a good phone. And then these are 2.4 gigahertz, which is what everything else runs now, which is your microwave oven and your Wi-Fi routers and all that stuff. So this is the bandwidth that they're using for these type of phones. Software for your hard drives to copy your hard drive, copy, drive image. Partition Magic. Wow. Partition Magic is one of those programs that like everybody had to use to partition your hard drive if you want to have different partitions to put either Linux or some sort of different operating systems. Antivirus. This is the antivirus everybody had. McAfee or Norton. This is actually Norton. The System Works. I hated System Works. System Works just killed your system. It was a full, like, internet and pop-up blocker and all that stuff, and it just slowed down your machine so bad. And I believe they came up with McAfee, which is the competitor, came out with 360 or something like that. It was just horrible. It would slow down your machine really bad. Oh, look at this. Hardware fix. Y2K issues. Oh, my God. If you guys don't know what Y2K is, look it up on the internet. You'll have a blast. Everybody thought the end of the world was going to end in 2000. And all the machines weren't going to work and all that good stuff. So these are fixes for your computer before 2000. Remember, this is 1998. Keyboards haven't really changed much. Mouse. Naturally, Dragon, naturally speaking, this was an amazing, amazing program when it came out. And it's still around now. It's owned by a different company. And I believe it's still called Naturally Speaking or Dragon or something like that. But it was really good. The only problem is you had to read like almost 30 minutes to train the program. And it was just exhausting to read a bunch of stuff out loud just to train the program when it came out. So that's that. WordPerfect 8. Corel was big into office suites. So Corel, you have Office Print, which I'm not sure what this is. This is probably some sort of, a publishing to make your own newsletters and stuff. I don't know if Microsoft Word's been around forever, but Office, I believe it should have been around. Here's Windows Works, Windows Works Deluxe, Windows Suite, which include Word 97, Works 4.5, Money, which was a money program for, I guess, like maybe a spreadsheet. No, it wasn't a spreadsheet. I don't know what the hell that was for. Never used it. Encarta Cyclopedia. Wow. There's a blast from the past. There was really no Google at that moment. So, you know, Wikipedia and all that stuff wasn't around. So if you wanted to know something about anything, world history, whatever, you would have to get an encyclopedia or, of course, look it up on the internet using InfoSeek, Excite, Netscape. I'm sure there's a couple of other ones I can't remember at the moment. But that was the Encyclopedia Encarta. Microsoft Project. Wow. Indeed, I use this a lot. A lot. So that's Microsoft Project. Office 97. So, okay. So Microsoft Office was around. So this is Microsoft Office 97 training. Via Graphics was a company that made a lot of training stuff, which was cool. MCSE training for networking, certification for Windows, NT workstations, and all that good stuff. That was a big thing to get into. If you wanted a computer job, you needed to be MSCE certified. Here's Office 97. Should have gotten some water. My mouth is completely dried out. Programming, Visual Basic. I started with Quick Basic, which I actually learned Basic as my first language. And it's just a coding language. It's nothing powerful or anything like that. Then Quick Basic came out, which was a very nice way to compile and make executable files. I learned that one very well as well. And then after that, Visual Studios came out, which was Visual Basic. Visual Basic came out, and that was really, really, really cool to create your own programs. And then .NET was a derivative of this. This became .NET, and then from .NET, ASP, and so on. I lost track after that. So that's what Visual Basic is. Upgrade to Windows 98. $89. I think they could have changed that around. That would have been cool. Windows NT was the hot thing to have. Basically more for offices. Here's the complete National Geographic for $150. Print Shop. Printmaster. These programs are as old as computers could be. Everybody owned either Printmaster or Print Shop. And these CDs were really funny because these are clip arts. We used to call them clip arts, which is just graphics that you can put on your presentations and stuff. And these things had, you know, 30,000, 200,000 clip arts. Excuse me. This kind of looks like the Quicken. Oh, it is Quicken. I was looking at the graphic. Quicken Family Lawyer. Where's Quicken? Quicken? The accounting one. I don't know. Corel Draw. Again, we spoke about that before. Illustrator 8.0. PageMaker. This was I used to use this program to make newsletters. This was a pro software, and this was somewhat expensive. The retail cost of this software by itself was $539. Photoshop 5 was, if you wanted to buy it, was $600. $600 for Adobe Photoshop. And I used Photoshop for a long time. I skipped a couple of versions because I was using an older version. And then from there, I just went directly to Photoshop 6 and then CC and so on. Illustrator, which I use, they were in version 8, and that was $349. I still can't get over Photoshop, $600 for Photoshop. Think about that. Uh, AutoCAD was the CAD software for computer-aided software design software. This was a training, I believe. Or no, this was kind of like a copy of it, a lot cheaper because CAD was like $1,000 and up, and this was only $400. Laser pointers. Okay, laser pointers, $17 for a laser pointer. You can get those for a dollar now. But they were big back, you know, you can get the bullet one for $19. Only $19. If you act now, we'll even include this funky looking one. Snappy. Snappy was cool. Snappy, you can capture video in high res. High res was actually, it says up to 1500 by whatever, but the resolution was like 600 by 480 was the resolution, and you can capture your videos and stuff through the computer. It's like a digitizer. It was a piece of shit, but it was very popular, that one and the Dazzle. So I believe it's the same company, if I'm correct. Let's just say it's the same company. Snappy was the cheaper version. Dazzle was the better version, and that was almost $300, $250, and you can capture your video. This was a better system. This was, I don't think this was the card. Yeah, you see? 600 by 480 resolution. I had one called Pinnacle. Pinnacle Systems, which is this same one, but it was a better card. I don't remember the name anymore. It's been too many years. Webcams. Look at the webcams. This is what webcams look like. Slide projectors to scanners. There was these little slides that you can. People use back in the 60s and early, really, really early 70s. A slide projector was a little photo on a little disc. And you can put them in there and then scan them if you still had those. It's $549 for that. Dying market. Look at this big ass. With night vision. Look at that big thing. That's a big, big camera. Here's the digital cameras. We've almost gone to the end and haven't seen a digital camera, but here's the digital camera right here. Casio. This is a 1.3 megapixel digital camera. And this was $699. $699 with only 8 megabytes of space. Which you can take maybe 60 pictures. And then it would fill up. And nowadays, one file is triple that size. In a regular memory. 1.4 megapixel camera. 1.4 megapixel camera. And the ranges is from $700 to $1,000. And there's a cheap one here for $399. And it comes with a 10 megabyte card. Smart media. No SD cards. Digital film, no SD cards. None of this stuff used SD cards. They used these little cards that were a little bit bigger. Well, actually way bigger than, this is a battery for inside an iPhone, but these memory cards were about the size of that. I got it. So they were pretty big. The world's fastest CD-ROM. What's the speed of this? 40x. Oh, this is a reader, though. 40x at the highest rate. I think they kind of maxed out like at 64 or at 52 or something like that. So who uses that stuff? Nobody uses that stuff anymore. Here's some more computer speakers. Kenwood. Well, guys, I hope you enjoyed the magazine. I'm sure I made a couple of errors in there. But if you guys enjoyed that, I have a couple of other older catalogs in this that I'm going to read to you guys and go through. Next time I'll make sure I get some water so my mouth doesn't dry up. And please make sure if you like the video, like it, comment, subscribe, and let me know what questions you have. I like to communicate through YouTube. So feel free to leave a comment, say what you want to see or you want me to revisit or you want me to talk more about. And I hope to see you on the next one. Thanks for joining. Take care.